Welcome to UGC CEC online lecture series. I am Dr. Divya Verma Gakhar, assistant professor in University School of Management Studies, Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University. In the series of lectures related to financial management, today we are going to talk about capital structure. All of us understand that business cannot run without money. From various sources, from where we'll generate the finances for a company, it is very important for a company to understand that what kind of cost is involved with each source of finance, how much risk is associated with each source of finance, and what can be the benefits of raising capital from various sources of finance. It can be possible for a startup company or for an entrepreneurial venture that not all sources of finance are available for them. So for such a company, whatever source of finance is available, let's say the equity capital is available for them because the promoter's shareholding they can generate. So in that case, they would rely only on equity share capital for their company. But if there is a company who can even raise money through debt or through preference share capital or by issuing shares to general public, then they can make a mix of all the various sources which they want to keep in their capital structure. So basically, when we are talking about capital structure decision, we are talking about financing decision of a company. So for taking financing decision of a company has to first of all decide that what are the sources, how much capital do they require. So they have to do financial planning for it. So in the process of doing financial planning, they have to see that what are the requirement of the company in terms of capital, in terms of long-term capital required and short-term capital required. Keeping in view the amount of capital which is required by the company in terms of long-term capital and the short-term classification of capital, they can then decide that, okay, what are the sources of finance that are available to us? So based on the sources of finance, for example, there can be various sources of finance, like there can be equity share capital, it can be preference share capital. So one can raise money through promoters investment in the capital, or we can also go for a public issue for the company. Then a company has to see that if borrowed capital as a source of finance is also available to them. So company can think of taking up a bank loan, company can think of raising money from general public in the form of bonds or debentures which they are issuing. So that is how a company will identify that which are the sources of finance that are available for a company. Now, all of these sources of finance will be a part of the liability side of the balance sheet of a company. So the long-term liabilities will include the equity share capital, preference share capital, any loans taken by the company for the long-term, or any debentures or bonds issued by the company. Now, is this amount of capital sources or the amount of capital raised from various sources, is it an important decision? Yes, it is a very important decision for a company. Why? Because each source of finance would have certain cost involved. Each source of finance would be having certain risk attached to it. Each source of finance will have its own benefits. So as a company, it has to be a strategic decision where the company is trying to decide that, okay, how much money they have to raise from the owner's capital, how much money they have to raise from the borrowed in the form of borrowings. So once a company decides that, okay, how much borrowings they are ready to have. Now, why borrowings are important, or why, what is the relevance of borrowings in a company's capital structure? Borrowings gives us an advantage of leverage. By having borrowed capital in our capital structure, we are able to generate more resources, we are able to generate more returns for the equity shareholder. Why? Because debt or borrowings is a cheaper source of finance. Debt or borrowings is a cheaper source of finance because it comes with a fixed rate of interest, which has to be paid annually, and which has to be paid even if there is no profit earned by the company. And secondly, this interest on loan or interest on debenture is tax deductible. That means you're going to adjust it from the expenditure side of the profit and loss account. So before charging your taxes you pay to the government, you can deduct the amount of interest paid on debentures or interest paid on loan. This is how interest on debentures or interest on loan is a cheaper source of finance as compared to equity capital or any other source of finance. So that is why company can get an advantage of leverage by using borrowed capital. Then we also have to see that is there any cost involved in issuing preference share capital, or what is the cost related to preference capital? There is a cost related to preference capital in terms of, because the preference shareholders, they get fixed rate of dividend. The cost is higher than the cost of debt, but for preference capital, the cost is little lower than the cost of equity, because they get a fixed rate of dividend and they are not the real owners of the company. So that is the benefit, you can say. So in case the owners do not want their ownership to be diluted, they would like to go for issuing preference share capital. Third source of finance can be equity capital. So if a company thinks of issuing equity shares, so then they are increasing their own capital of the company, and they are also going to increase their the ownership rights will be distributed amongst number of shareholders which they have. But does equity capital comes at a cost? Yes, definitely. Equity capital comes at a cost because there is opportunity cost. Even if the profit, which is, if a company doesn't earn profit and doesn't pay to dividend to their equity shareholder, still there is an opportunity cost to equity capital, because equity shareholders have certain expectations from the company in terms of how much returns, regular returns of dividend company is going to pay, and or how much capital gain the company is going to give them in terms of increase in share price or return on investment they will get from the company, even if the company is plowing back all the profits. Similarly, plowing back of profits or retained earnings also has a cost, or also has a cost involved. So looking at various kind of cost which exist for various sources of finance, a company has to decide that which cost or which source of finance they should opt for. It may be possible that for certain companies there is some amount of some source of finance which is not at all available. So in that case it can be a different story, but in case a company can raise money from all the sources of finance, a company can decide based on the cost and benefit attached to each source of finance that which source of finance they would like to use for raising capital for the company. So once a company decides that a company is going to use a mix of borrowed capital plus equity capital, because borrowed capital will give its own advantages and borrowed capital is a cheaper source of finance, so a company can think of rest of the other decisions which are important. Now, keeping in view all of these concepts, we need to understand the concept of capital structure, or why and how the capital structure decisions are important for a company. So when we are issuing borrowed capital, it is cheaper source of finance. Two things to remember. And then it comes at a cost. What is the cost of issuing borrowed capital? The cost of issuing borrowed capital is that if a company has borrowed capital and the company is not able to make the payment of principal or interest on loan on time, then these people can take the company to the court and can liquidate the company. So this can affect the solvency position of a company. So those companies who have more borrowed capital or more debt in their capital structure, so they are subject to more higher risk in terms of solvency, of the long-term solvency of the company. Those companies which are only equity company, their solvency position is much more better than those companies who have some amount of borrowed capital attached to it. So that is why it is not always advisable to have borrowed capital more than a certain limit. So that is the risk attached to the borrowed capital. Similarly, there is dilution of equity capital will take place if there will be more equity shares or the equity will be issued by the company. So in that case, a company can decide that, okay, there has to be a mix of some amount of equity capital issued by the company and some amount of loans or debentures or bonds issued by the company, so that there's a proper mix of or a blend of equity capital as well as debt capital in the capital structure of a company. Keeping in view of this background, we will look at the capital structure decision and various theories which are related to capital structure decision. So based on the various theories, there are two schools of thought which exist for capital structure. One is a relevant school of thought, another one is an irrelevant school of thought. As per the relevant school of thought, there are the relevant school of thought propounds that capital structure is a relevant decision. If a company will take capital structure decision, then it is going to affect the wealth of the shareholders or it is going to affect the value of the firm. How come capital structure is a relevant decision? So if any changes in capital structure the company is making and it is going to affect the value of share in the stock market or the price of the share in the stock market, then it is known as a relevant decision. So there are two schools of thought which exist under this relevant school of thought, net income approach and traditional approach. Then we have irrelevant school of thought. People who follow irrelevant school of thought, they say that capital structure decision is not a very relevant decision. It is not going to affect the wealth of the shareholder, so it cannot be a strategic decision. It is a routine decision for the company, and they have tried to prove it by two different theories. One is net operating income approach and Modigliani-Miller approach. Now, talking about the concept of capital structure, what is capital structure? Let's talk about the meaning of capital structure. Capital structure is a mix or proportion of firm's permanent long-term financing represented by debt, preferred stock and common stock equity. There's a concept of optimum capital structure. The optimum capital structure is that capital structure which minimizes the firm's cost of capital and thereby maximizes the value of firm. When we are talking about capital structure, we need to be careful with two things. We need to understand that what are the various costs attached to sources of finance which our company is going to get and how much sources of finance we need to raise, how much is the amount of money which is required to be raised by the company, what kind of assets we are going to buy with that, and how much is the cost involved for each source of finance, and how much is the risk attached to it. So based on a blend of such a mix of debt and equity that a company is able to minimize its cost and is able to maximize the wealth of the shareholder or the value of the firm. So that level of capital structure or that mix of capital structure of debt and equity will be known as an optimum capital structure. And a company can think of adopting such a capital structure so that a company is able to at least good returns on the shareholders. Now let's talk about the approaches to capital structure. So we'll first talk about the relevant school of thought, which explains that capital structure is a relevant decision. How capital structure is a relevant decision? We'll first talk about the theory related to it, net income approach. According to net income approach, cost of debt and cost of equity remains unchanged when debt equity or degree of leverage varies for a company, which means overall cost of capital KO will decline when more debt will be used by the company. As a result, the overall cost of capital declines and the firm value increases with debt. How net income approach has tried to explain the capital structure? It says that debt is a cheaper source of finance. So on this graph, if you can see that on the x-axis we have the debt and on the y-axis we have the cost. So cost of debt is a cheaper source of finance, so it is lying little lower to the cost of equity capital. And they say this theory says that cost of debt remains constant and it is lower than the cost of equity. And cost of equity also remains constant, it is higher than the cost of debt. So as a company will start using more amount of debt in their capital structure. So as the amount of debt will increase in the capital structure, the overall cost of capital by using more amount of debt, because overall cost of capital is weighted average of cost of equity plus cost of debt. So by using overall cost of capital, by using a combination of debt plus equity in the capital structure, a company will be able to reduce its overall cost of capital. If a company will increase its debt amount to 50%, So cost, overall cost of capital will decline. If it will increase its amount of debt to 75% or even more than that, so overall cost of capital will keep on declining, and it may reach, if a company use 100% borrowed capital, so it may reach to equal to cost of, overall cost of capital can be equal to cost of debt. So this is how graphically they have tried to explain it, and the basis of this theory is that overall cost of capital will decline. Once the overall cost of capital will decline, the firm value will increase with the amount of debt used by the company. Second approach is net operating income approach. As per net operating income approach, the value of the firm and the weighted average cost of capital are independent of firm's capital structure. That means value of the firm is not going to affect the is not going to be affected by the weighted average cost of capital. More use of cheaper source of finance will increase the cost of equity capital, so that overall cost of capital will be constant. And the value of a firm is a function of business efficiency or operating income. As per net operating income approach, it is suggested that cost of capital, cost of equity capital, does not remain constant, and it increases with the increase in borrowed capital by the company. So net operating income's approach says that cost of overall cost of capital for a company will always remain constant by increasing or decreasing the amount of debt. It is not going to change. So that is why the value of the firm or the wealth of the shareholders can be maximized by improving the business efficiency of the company, not the operating income of the company. How they have tried to explain it: on x-axis we have the debt capital of the company, and on y-axis we have the cost attached to it. So cost of debt is a cheaper source of finance, so you can see that cost of debt is lying on a at a lower value in the on the y-axis, and cost of equity is on a higher at a higher level. So as a company will increase the proportion of debt capital in their capital structure, it says that cost of equity will increase. How much cost of equity will increase? So whatever benefit a company will get by including cost of debt in their capital structure, benefit in terms of reduction in overall cost of capital, that will be exactly offset by the amount of increase in cost of equity because of higher risk of the company, higher financial risk of the company, and the expectation of equity shareholder will be that the company should give them higher returns. So by using more debt capital in the capital structure, expectation of equity shareholders, because they start taking higher risk in the company, their expectation from the company increases in terms of returns, and their expectation is reflected in the cost of the company. So overall cost of capital will remain constant, because whatever cost of debt benefit the company could get by reduction, by including cost of debt in their capital structure, that is exactly offset by the increase in the expectation of returns by the equity shareholders, because they are going to take higher financial risk of the company, and so the cost of equity is going to rise. The more debt a company will use, cost of equity will keep on rising. So thus it will lead to no change in the cost of overall cost of capital. So that means by including debt in the capital structure or by not including debt in the capital structure, overall cost of capital, if is going to remain constant, that means capital structure decision is an irrelevant decision. So this is how the net operating income approach has tried to explain the that how capital structure is an irrelevant decision, and they suggest that this decision is not going to affect the wealth of the shareholders. So ultimately, if a company wants to improve the wealth of the shareholders, they should look for improving on business efficiency or operating efficiency of the company, rather than looking for improving the wealth of the shareholder through taking a capital structure decision. Third theory is traditional approach. As per the traditional approach, it suggests, the traditional approach argues that moderate degree of debt can lower the firm's overall cost of capital and thereby increase the firm's value. The initial increase in the cost of equity is more than offset by the lower cost of debt. But as debt increases, shareholders perceive higher risk and the cost of equity rises and overall cost of capital also increases for the company. But they've suggested a term called optimum capital structure. So they say that optimum capital structure will be at a point where overall cost of capital is minimum. Traditional approach seems to be very genuine and an approach which is most likely applicable in the present scenario. Because traditional approach argues that some amount of debt for any company is advisable because debt is a cheaper source of finance and a company can get advantages by using more of the debt capital in their capital structure. So what will happen that a firm can reduce their overall cost of capital by using some amount of debt capital in the capital structure because debt is a cheaper source of finance. But they say that beyond a point, if you keep on increasing the amount of borrowed capital or debt capital in the capital structure of a company, then beyond a point, it will increase the solvency risk of the company and it will increase the financial risk, which for which the equity shareholder will start expecting higher returns from the company. So cost of equity will start rising if borrowed capital or usage of borrowed capital increases beyond a particular limit in a company. So that is why this theory recommends that debt should be used as a cheaper source of finance up to a certain limit. After that, if a company will use the amount of debt, the cost of equity will start rising and because of which overall cost of capital will also increase. So then a company should look for issuing debt in such a way that it is up to a level where you have the overall cost of capital can be minimized and it is the optimum capital structure that can be achieved. Now look at this graph. On the x-axis we have debt capital and on y-axis we have various kind of cost. So cost of debt is cheaper and cost of debt is constant. If you see the behavior of cost of equity, it is initially constant and later on it is increasing. And overall cost of capital, if you see, is declining initially up to a certain point, and after that overall cost of capital also starts rising. Now this theory explains that cost of debt is a cheaper source of finance, and as a company will start employing more debt in their capital structure. So because of this, overall cost of capital will start declining, and it will decline to a certain level. There will be a point which will be known as the optimum capital structure. There will be a point where the overall cost of capital for the company is minimized because of usage of more borrowed capital in their capital structure. After that point, if a company will increase the amount of debt capital in their capital structure, equity shareholders' risk will increase and they will start expecting higher returns from the company. And this will lead to increase in overall cost of capital. So if a company wants to have a mix of debt and equity, then they should employ more debt till the point they reach to the optimum capital structure level. Beyond that, increasing the amount of debt in their capital structure is not going to help in any way the company. So that is how a company can decide that how much borrowed capital or equity capital mix or what kind of mix they can have for their capital structure.